what's happening around the world and what's happening here at home. A very good evening to you and welcome to Weekend Primetime News. I'm Sandro Ferdinando and here are your headlines for tonight.
Elephant death toll in Digampatana Tumbikulam rises to 7, remains sent to the government analyst. SB Navinna pledges support to UNP presidential candidate Sajith Premadasa. Gotabaya, Mahinda and Basil meet President Sirisena. SLFP says the next 48 hours are decisive. Heavy downpours accompanied with severe lightning. Weather warnings issued.
First up in local news, the remains of another three elephants suspected to have died of food poisoning were found today, bringing the total count to 7.
It was heartbreaking to witness the sight of this elephant calf remaining close to his mother, who no longer breathes. The remains of four elephants were first discovered last morning in the Habarana, Digampataha, Hirivadunna and Tumbikulam forest reserves. The remains of two elephants were discovered near the Hirivadunna Vava, while the remains of the other two elephants were discovered inside the forest reserve adjacent to the Vava. The remains of another elephant was discovered this morning near the Hirivadunna Vava. Subsequently, the remains of another two elephants were discovered in the Tumbikulam Forest Reserve. Accordingly, as of now, the remains of 7 elephants, all between the ages of 20 and 30 years, have been discovered. Subsequently, wildlife officers launched a search operation in an attempt to discover the remains of more elephants.
Three more wild elephants were discovered today in the Habarana area. It was a silent death. No one knows what the cause was for these elephants' deaths. The area, the wildlife department and the area residents are still wondering the reason for these elephants' deaths.
Accordingly, 7 teams were engaged in operations across the Tumbikulam Forest Reserve. Chandra Bandar Naik, an official from the Sigiriya Wildlife Protection Zone, said there was a suspicion as to whether these elephants had died of food poisoning. However, the post-mortem that was performed on the remains of 2 elephants yesterday did not reveal an exact reason for the deaths of these elephants. Wildlife veterinary surgeon in Girithale, Dinusha De Silva, prepared to perform the post-mortem on the remains of another elephant this morning. However, the procedure had to be delayed as the calf of the deceased elephant refused to leave its mother. Subsequently, the wildlife officers were compelled to sedate the elephant calf and perform the post-mortem afterwards.
We are saddened by this horrific incident. Rumor has it these elephants were poisoned. However, I do not think these rumors are true, as elephants are a national asset.
It's hard to bear such a painful loss. It's true, elephants destroy our crops, but the loss of an elephant saddens all of us.
7 or 8 years ago, similar to the present situation, the remains of elephants, cows and many other animals were discovered. We did not know the reason for their death. Even today, the elephants that have died are all females and of the same age. I urge wildlife officers and the police to look into this matter and to identify whether the deaths have been caused after contracting a disease or something else. These animals must be protected. The post-mortem on the remains of the remaining elephant is due to be performed.
As revealing certain information might obstruct further investigation, all I can say is, these deaths were the result of some form of human activity. Based on data obtained so far, we are in the process of preparing a report. Generally, female elephants roam in herds. We can assume the diseased elephants were part of a herd.
The wildlife officers will conduct further investigations into this matter. If this does not prove to be a success, we will send the samples to the research department to ascertain the cause of death. Afterwards, we will proceed further.
If the cause of death of these elephants is human activity, we will take necessary legal action against the perpetrators. Director General of the Department of Wildlife Conservation, Chandana Surya Bandara, says remains of the elephants will be sent to the Government Analysts Department. The Director General said although a post-mortem examination was done on the remains of the elephant, a definite reason for the cause of the deaths had not been ascertained. The Director General added that a probe into the deaths has been launched by the Department of Wildlife Conservation as well as the police.
Meanwhile, Department of Meteorology says that thunder showers accompanied by severe lightning are likely to occur at several places in western Sabaragamuwa, southern, central, Uwa and northwestern provinces and in Manaar and Pulonan districts in the evening or night. Now, wishing a weather advisory to the department said that the temporarily strong gusts of winds up to 70 to 80 kilometers per hour are also possible during thunder showers.
The Department of Meteorology advises the general public to seek shelter, preferably indoors and never under trees. Avoid open areas such as paddy fields, tea plantations and open water bodies during thunderstorms. Avoid using wired telephones and connected electrical appliances during thunderstorms. Avoid using open vehicles such as bicycles, tractors and boats. Beware of fallen trees and power lines. Meanwhile, around 240 houses in several parts of the country were damaged due to strong gusty winds. Vehicular movement along the Colombo-Ratnapura main road was hampered last night for several hours due to uprooted trees which had fallen onto the road. Officers of the Sri Lanka Army in Kuruvita, together with the area residents and relief groups, immediately took measures to clear one lane along the road. Vehicular movement along the Colombo-Ratnapura main road has now returned to normalcy. 94 houses in Ratnapura Newtown, Veralupa, Kospalavinna, Durian Gasdeka, and several other areas were damaged due to strong winds. Power supply in these areas was also hampered due to uprooted trees. Our correspondent said officials of the Ceylon Electricity Board contributed immensely to restore the power supply in these areas. Around 150 houses in Aswatta South in Avissavella, Miriswatta, Hingurala and Aswatta North were damaged due to strong gusty winds. Fallen trees have disrupted the power supply to the area and steps have been taken to provide relief to those affected.
UNP MP SB Navin, who distanced himself from the party for some time, rejoined the party and pledged his support to the presidential candidate of the United National Party, Sajith Premadasa. He made this announcement during a media briefing at Minister Mangala Samaravira's official residence in Colombo.
Deputy leader of the United National Party, Minister Sajith Premadasa, and several other representatives of the UMP attended the media briefing.
The Sri Lanka Freedom Party had a victorious political journey of 35 years. If I join this party, we can be victorious. Nobody will worry about differences when supporting him during the election. I made this decision based on his honesty, humbleness, skill and the willingness to serve the country. I, right at the time, said that I will be supporting him. He will be a president at a younger age. There is no doubt there. I will win the northwestern province every time I contest. So we will do our best to make him win. There's a lot more who support him, so I will not further elaborate on it. People living in Sri Lanka as well as in foreign countries know how I carried out my duties as a minister. There's nothing extraordinary to do here, is there? But if I didn't do anything for the past 4.5 years and now suddenly appear out of nowhere, it's fair to ask that question.
And are you open to working with the SNLP in this election?
I am open to anybody who is accepting the principles and the policy agenda that I believe in.
Some politicians who have corruption charges, they come to the meeting. Are you open to anybody?
I have not heard of anybody with corruption charges who are trying to join up with me. Yeah, if those politicians have been concluded in a court of law or in any tribunal that they have implemented misdeeds or misdemeanors, certainly I would not encourage them.
I don't have heaps of dollars to carry out my campaigning activities, so my only hope is the assistance of the people of this country.
Journalists raised questions about controversial ACSA, SOFA and MCC agreements.
No, as far as international agreements are concerned, as with any other policy decision, first most priority is the national interest. So what I would do is have a fresh look at all international political agreements, economic agreements, trade agreements. I will have a very transparent procedure whereby we enlist the support of all stakeholders, including specialists in those particular topics. We shall do a very thorough cost-benefit analysis. If the benefits outweigh the costs, that will be government policy. Socio, economic, political, trade, political security, defense, all those are included.
Journalists also raised questions about the plans of the presidential candidate after he gets elected as a president.
Well, I think the major changes, the first major change I would be making is ensure that the taxpayers' rupees are less spent on the executive. And I will use the bare minimum, what is necessary for me to carry out the duties, and the rest of the funding will go to the people and people's development-oriented development agenda. That's the very first thing I will do.
I am working on a mechanism to prevent corruption from taking place without political interference. It doesn't matter if these happen in the past or outdated.
Minister Dr. Rajat Sinharatne expressed the following views in Kadavata today regarding election propaganda activities that have been planned for Minister Sajith Premadasa's presidential election campaign.
We will conduct our election campaign at three places. One will be conducted at the Sirikota party headquarters as the party as a whole. One will be at the main headquarters at Vauxhall Street. The third propaganda campaign will be at the centre in Thimbirigasiaya, where the campaign of President Maithripala Sirisena was also held. We will carry out propaganda activities in all three centres. We will coordinate the propaganda activities in all three stations.
Former Chief Minister of Northern Province Justice C.V. Vigneswaran says he is personally happy that Minister Sajith Premadasa has been picked upon as the UNP presidential candidate.
Responding to a question raised by journalists, the former chief minister said, and I quote, he has an attitude of live and let live nurtured by Royal College education and Buddhism and maybe also his London School of Economics education. He added that Minister Premadasa did well with youth through his Taruna Savya apart from Jana Suvya and Sasuna Tarana. The former chief minister concluded his statement saying, and I quote, he could well prove to be an excellent president for all communities despite president's powers being clipped by law in recent times.
Foreign Secretary Ravinath Arisinghe, who is presently leading the Sri Lanka delegation to the 74th UN General Assembly session, met with the Undersecretary General of UNDPO, Jean-Pierre Lacroix, to discuss obstacles placed on Sri Lanka's peacekeeping contribution to the UN.
The Minister of Foreign Affairs said upon the Foreign Secretary seeking clarification on the statement made on the 25th of September 2019 by the Deputy Spokesperson of the United Nations Secretary General relating to Sri Lankan troops deployed for UN peacekeeping, the Undersecretary General stated that only 25% of the troops from Sri Lanka presently engaged in peacekeeping operations will be replaced when they complete their term in Lebanon. He added that these places will be filled through a readjustment of existing peacekeepers presently in Lebanon. Undersecretary General Lacroix confirmed that there will be no further reduction of Sri Lankan peacekeepers. in the communication on the part of the government of Sri Lanka with the United Nations Department of Peacekeeping Organization, it has pointed out that the appointment of Lieutenant General Shavendra Silva as the army commander has no link to the suitability and engagement of the army personnel being nominated for UN peacekeeping operations, who are thoroughly jointly vetted, and therefore it is unacceptable to penalize these troops through punitive action on them personally.
Furthermore, the Foreign Secretary Ravinath Arisinghe has welcomed the proposal for the readmission of the Maldives to the Commonwealth, reiterating that Sri Lanka fully supports the fast-track procedure to allow the Maldives to participate fully at Shogam 2020 in Rwanda.
He made this observation at the Commonwealth Foreign Affairs Ministers meeting held in New York on the sidelines of the 74th Assembly of the United Nations General Assembly. The Maldives applied to rejoin the Commonwealth on the 12th of June 2019. Meanwhile, Sri Lanka and Ukraine, enhancing tourism and trade relations between the two countries, have entered into an agreement on visa exemptions for their nationals holding diplomatic, service or official passports. Secretary of Foreign Affairs Ravinath Arisinghe and Vadim Pristaiko, Minister of Foreign Affairs of Ukraine, signed the agreement at the United Nations headquarters in New York on the 26th of September 2019.
Meanwhile, a meeting between the presidential candidate of the Sri Lanka, Pulajana Perumuna Gotabe Rajapaksa, and President Maithripala Sirisena was held at the presidential secretariat this afternoon.
According to our reporters, the meeting commenced at around 12:15 p.m. and went on for 45 minutes. It was reported that leader of the Pudujana Perumuna Mahinda Rajapaksa and national organizer of the party Basil Rajapaksa had also joined this meeting along with Gotabe Rajapaksa.
Prior to this discussion, a meeting between President Maithripala Sirisena and members of parliament representing the SLFP took place last night at the president's official residence in Colombo. We believe the Central Working Committee will discuss this matter and reach a final decision on Monday. However, the SLFP only held discussions with the SLPP and not with other parties. Therefore, we decided that we must hold discussions with other parties as well. Accordingly, prior to discussions with the Central Working Committee, we plan to hold discussions with other political parties during the weekend. On Monday, a final decision will be reached. As a party, we have an idea of our plans. However, we will reach a final decision after holding discussions with other political parties as well.
ඒ සාකච්ඡාවේ අන්තිම අධියරේ තියෙන
ජනාධිපති නැවත ඉල්ලයිද
අපිට තව පැය 48ක්
තියෙනවා 48ට අනිවාර්යෙන් නිදහස් පක්ෂයේ තීරණාත්මකයි
අනිවාර්යෙන්ම මේ රටේ දේශපාලන තීරණාත්මක يعني සමුදාපේ මධ්‍යම කාරක සභාව තියෙකදී අපි තීන්දුව ප්‍රකාශරිපත් කරනවා
As per the decision taken by the group of MPs President Maithripala Sirisena met with the representatives of the leftist parties which support the SLPP this morning at the president's official residence. It was reported several parliamentarians including Vasudevana Nayakara, Dinesh Gunawardena, Vimal Veerawansa, Uday Gammanpila, D.E.W. Gunasekara and Thissa Vitharana attended the meeting. A representative of the SLPP who attended the meeting said the importance and necessity for the SLFP and SLPP to face the upcoming elections together was highlighted during the meeting.
Now, before holding discussions with President Maithripala Sirisena, Gotabe Rajapaksa and Mahinda Rajapaksa attended the National Farmers Summit of Sri Lanka, Pudujana Perumuna.
The summit was held at the Sri Lanka Exhibition and Convention Centre in parallel to the National Conference of Agricultural Research and Production Assistant Officers. Party leader Mahinda Rajapaksa first attended the event. Thereafter, presidential candidate Gotabe Rajapaksa attended the event. When the government fails to give priority for agriculture in the agricultural sector, various issues arise. We will introduce a national policy for the agricultural sector. The reason why the second and third generations of farmers distance themselves from agriculture is because for generations they have observed how the farmers suffer due to poverty. We should provide answers for these issues. Under our government, we have a proper vision on how to modernize the agricultural sector and how to utilize modern technology. The main objective of this is to uplift the income of families that depend on agriculture. In our government, the main policy will be to protect the farmer.
රජයක් තුල අපේ ප්‍රතිපත්තිය තියෙන්නේ සෑම විටම ගොවියා ආරක්ෂා කර ගැනීමටයි.
Gotabe Rajapaksa left the event following his speech and Mahinda Rajapaksa addressed the gathering.
ගෞරවය, ආදරය, වීරත්වය මේ සියල්ල ඔබයි. ශ්‍රී ලංකා ප්‍රජාතාන්ත්‍රික සමාජවාදී ජනරජයේ පස්වන විධායක ජනාධිපති අතිගරු මහින්ද රාජපක්ෂ මහත්මයාට ගෞරවයෙන් ආරාධනා කරනවා.
අද විශේෂයෙන්ම අපි මේ කලබලෙන් කතා කරන්නේ.
The reason we are in such a hurry today is because we have been called to discuss on a party gathering. It is scheduled to commence at 12. We already received two messages past 12. Gotabe was quickly sent off. Even I have to be present there, so I won't take much time. There's no point in preaching about politics in front of you. You already know the cost of living, lack of job opportunities, and the attention paid on farmers in the present times better than me. I wish you all a prosperous future. Please excuse me to attend that meeting.
අර සාකච්ඡාවට යන්න අවස්ථාව ලබා දෙන්නේ කියලා ඉල්ලා සිටිමි. ඔබ සියලු දෙනාටම සුභ අනාගතයක් පතමි.
National organizer of the Janata Vimukti Peramuna, Bimal Ratnayaka, expressed the following views at the opening of the District Operational Center of the National People's Power Movement in Trincomalee.
Who was the Vice President of Sri Lanka before 8th of January 2015? It was Gotabe Rajapaksa, wasn't it? There were several strange stories that he was a secretary. No, he was the Vice President. It was only Mahinda Rajapaksa above Gotabe Rajapaksa. The whole cabinet of ministers were below him. Ministers have cried with us. It is not a fresh start of power for him. Gotabe Rajapaksa had been in power as the second in command for 10 years. Therefore, all offences that Mahinda Rajapaksa committed, Gotabe Rajapaksa is also connected. He has about 20,000 in his intelligence units, yet none of them realize that Mahinda Rajapaksa is going to get defeated.
A discussion was held between the senior vice president of the Sri Lanka Freedom Party, Nimal Siripala de Silva, and the representatives of the Sri Lanka Podujana Perumuna in Haliyala Divisional Secretariat this morning.
The discussion took place at the residence of the chairman of the Haliyala Divisional Secretariat, Nimal Sena Nayaka. Discussion was not open for public and representatives of Podujana Perumuna, and the ministers of Haliyala Divisional Secretariat were also present at the meeting. Discussions took place for several hours.
Sir, what do you want to do, sir? Otherwise, sir?
Please cut without this.
Earnings from exports have declined by 7% year-on-year during the month of July 2019, pushing the trade deficit to further widen by 401 million UN dollars when compared with June 2019.
In July of 2019, foreign investments in the Colombo Stock Exchange recorded a notable inflow of 44 million US dollars. However, during the year up to July, inflows to the stock exchange have declined by 32% compared to the corresponding period last year. During the period up to July this year, total foreign direct investment amounted to 262 million US dollars, a decline of approximately 22% compared to the corresponding period last year. Foreign investments in government securities recorded a net outflow of 33 million US dollars in July of 2019.
Exports declined by $75 million, which were mainly comprised of agri exports, $14 million was tea and spices, $8 million. And the balance was petroleum products because crude prices came down relative to last year, which were down by $25 million. On the import side, vehicles was down by $42 million. And fuel was down 31 million. We also saw a significant increase in flows into the equity market in the month of July. Most of that increase was due to a transfer of LOLC finance to a foreign entity. So I believe the local holding company transferred it to an overseas entity, which accounted for the bulk of the inflow into the stock exchange.
Gone mad though with those who struggle to make ends meet. With the people, for the people.
Up next is Action TV.
Exaggerating facts regarding the Lok Vijay coal power plant in Noratchole, the Minister of Power and Renewable Energy submitted a cabinet memorandum on the 10th of this month. Action TV revealed this matter on Thursday last week. The purpose of this cabinet memorandum is to construct a fourth coal power plant with a capacity of 300 megawatts in Noratchole that would contribute to the national power grid by 2023. However, this plan goes against the Electricity Act, as the proposed plan to obtain a loan from the Chinese government for this project is not considered as a loan transaction taking place between two governments. The expected loan is to be obtained directly by the Ceylon Electricity Board. As per the Electricity Act of Sri Lanka, the construction of a new power plant is considered as purchasing power. The cost of generating one unit of power must be considered, in other words, calling bids at competitive prices. The minister presenting this cabinet memorandum to obtain approval for a loan to construct the fourth phase of the Noratchole power plant is an obstruction to the competitive process and paves the way for looting and corruption. Likewise, this would result in the addition of 300 megawatts of power to the national grid at a higher cost. This cabinet memorandum is similar to a blank cheque that is to be signed, as the cabinet memorandum does not include any information regarding the value of the loan that is to be obtained from the Chinese government. The ministry, under the guise of the long-term power generation plan, uses the construction of the fourth phase of the Noratchole power plant against the Electricity Act of Sri Lanka. Against such a backdrop, vast statements regarding the purchasing of power amounting to 200 megawatts from a barge owned by a Turkish company was proved to be nothing but fake. Stay tuned for more revelations about the true nature of the Noratchole power plant tomorrow on Action TV.
The Railway Department said that 7 trains operated towards Fort Colombo this morning despite the strike action launched. Superintendent of Railways Gamini Siniratna said that trains from Kandy, Mahava, Veyangoda, Gaul, Avisavela and Shillau arrived in Fort Colombo. Now, drivers' trade unions said that the strike action will not be called off until solutions to issues including salary anomalies are provided. Meanwhile, a research by the Asian Development Bank has found that Sri Lanka spends US$19 million, that is approximately 3.4 billion rupees annually, on healthcare due to floods and droughts.
While the total cost of expenditure borne by the local government due to the ongoing floods is yet to be determined, a report published by the Ministry of Disaster Management revealed that total damages and losses across 5 districts owing to the severe flooding and landslides in May of 2017 amounted to approximately 70.4 billion rupees. While losses and damages can be quantified, the opportunity cost and other hidden costs incurred by the country due to climate change and natural disasters will only reflect in the country's long-term growth. The 2019 Long-Term Climate Risk Index, published by German Watch, has identified Sri Lanka as the second most vulnerable nation to climate change, coming just behind Puerto Rico. Economists warn weather changes will result in low per capita consumption levels that could further increase poverty and inequality across the country and much of South Asia.
It has been revealed that the total cost of the damage caused by flooding near the Irrinamadu Reservoir on the 21st of December 2018 had exceeded over 3,400 million rupees. This was revealed following an investigation conducted on the disaster situation in the Irrinamadu Reservoir.
Following an investigation that was launched based on the request by the governor of the Northern Province, the findings have indicated a loss of 64.25 million rupees to the government due to the disaster situation. A copy of the report has been handed over to the governor of the Northern Province and it states that the cost of the property loss incurred by the general public stands at 3,342.99 million rupees. The report accuses the director of irrigation in the Northern Province, a deputy director of irrigation in Kilinochi, and an engineer linked to the irrigation system in Kilinochi. They have been accused for their failure in managing the disaster situation in a proper manner. The report cites that the night before the flooding, the technological officer in charge of the activities at the reservoir was not present. It further notes that the officer had not applied for leave in the correct manner. Based on the provisions of the Asian Development Bank, a cost of 2,198 million rupees had been allocated for the development activities in the Irrawaddy Reservoir.
A large number of dead fish have been washed ashore along the Maruganpuri beach in Trincomalee today.
According to our correspondent, the fish were discovered at around 3 p.m. today. The fishermen have captured 60,000 kilograms of fish in one go. The fishermen were facing difficulties in reeling the nets due to excessive weight.
Founder of the Pathfinder Foundation and former minister Milinda Moragoda called on presidential candidates to consider including a five-year ban on university and campus political activities in their policy platforms.
Issuing a release, the former minister says, quote, "In all democracies, campus political activities are considered to be an important component of building the next generation of national leaders. Unfortunately, the vicious and vitriolic nature of campus politics in Sri Lanka has led to the whole fabric of the higher education system in the country being destroyed," end quote. Therefore, he says a five-year ban on university political activities should be used to reset and change the existing culture within national campuses. The release added that initiatives would be complemented by compulsory military service model that Milinda Moragoda proposed to presidential candidates. This program would require all men, in the first instance, upon reaching the age of 18 years, to serve in active duty as full-time servicemen in the Army, Navy, Air Force or Police. Compulsory military service would be implemented comprehensively to all Sri Lankans, regardless of social position, ethnic origin or religious backgrounds.
World Bank, in its latest report, Sri Lanka Human Capital Development, says that developing its human capital to a new and higher level will be key for Sri Lanka to become an upper-middle-income economy.
The report notes that if the current education and health conditions persist, a child born in Sri Lanka today will be about half as productive as she or he could have been if they had enjoyed complete education and full health. It added, quote, "Greater resources and policy attention are needed for provinces where human capital is less advanced, while also making rapid improvements in human capital in the more advanced provinces," end quote.
And thank you very much for joining us. Do take care and good night.